Hello and welcome or welcome back to the Tiny Fibre Studio. I'm Bex and this is the second in a series of videos about measuring and planning projects with handspun yarn. In the previous video, I talked about how I use wraps per inch as one of my quick reference measurements to help me stay consistent while I'm spinning and also as a rough guide when I'm deciding how to knit, weave or crochet with my handspun. But wraps per inch is only part of the picture, especially when it comes to project planning. Now, of course, not every spin has to be planned. There is absolutely nothing wrong with just spinning your fibre however you want to spin it, enjoying the process and figuring out what to do with it later. But if you do decide to plan for a project, one of the first questions that you might be faced with is how much fibre do I need? You don't want to run out, especially if it's a fibre that you can't buy more of. You could just buy the equivalent of your body weight in fibre and hope for the best, but you know, most of us are on some kind of budget. Fortunately, there is a yarn measurement that you can use to help you spin just what you need, and that is Grist. If you're not planning for anything in particular and you just want to spin first and pick a project later, you might still find Grist useful. In this video, I'll talk about how I use it for project planning and record keeping, along with how to change the Grist of your yarn. And of course, how to calculate it in the first place. I'm going to make the maths as simple as possible, but if you struggle with maths or you just want a great shortcut, stick around until the end because I've been working on something that I hope you're going to love. But first, what is Grist? Grist is a measurement of the linear density of yarn, the length of yarn that you would get in a given weight of fibre. Two yarns of the same weight might have different yardage depending on how thick or thin they are. But even if they're the same thickness, their density might be different depending on what kind of fibre has been used, how much twist was added, how much air is in the yarn, along with a whole host of other factors, but we'll talk more about those later. For now, let's focus on the Grist measurement itself, which is more familiar than you might think. For example, if you knit or crochet, you're probably familiar with the fact that most commercial fingering weight or sock weight yarns have something in the region of 400 meters per 100 grams, or roughly 440 yards per 3.5 ounces. 400 meters per 100 grams is one way of stating the grist. In hand spinning, you'll often come across grist written in imperial measurements, particularly yards per pound, abbreviated to YPP, but it's exactly the same concept. You have one figure for the length of the yarn, one for the weight, and the word per in the middle. For this video, I'm going to use two units of grist, which I think are the most commonly used in the spinning community, and that is yards per pound and meters per 100 grams. Let's say I have two skeins of yarn. One is a standard fingering weight, so 400 meters per 100 grams. The other is 892 meters and weighs 223 grams. Now, I don't know about you, but I would personally find it very difficult to mentally compare the first yarn to the second. So by converting the actual weight and length of our skein to a standard grist figure like yards per pound or meters per 100 grams, it's easier to be able to compare one yarn to another. I'll get into more detail shortly, including all of the imperial calculations, but just as a quick example, if we divide the length, 892 meters, by the weight, 223 grams, that gives us the number of meters in a single gram, so 4 meters per single gram. But I want to know how many meters in 100 grams, so I multiply that 4 meters by 100, and I get 400 meters per 100 grams. It's exactly the same as the first one. Does that mean that they will be the same thickness or produce the same fabric? No, probably not. Although there are charts which convert grist to standard yarn weights like fingering, DK, bulky, etc., they're usually just an estimate based on commercial standards, and they could be wildly misleading if you try to apply them directly to handspun, which is often more dense than an equivalent commercial yarn. I can't stress enough that the most important thing when you are assessing any yarn's suitability for a project is to swatch with it to find out its preferred gauge and also make sure that you like the fabric that it creates. Although comparing grists doesn't tell you everything about a yarn, by working out the grist of a handspun sample, you can also calculate how much fibre you need to spin to get the yardage that you need for a particular project. Or you could look at your records from a yarn that you spun previously from a similar fibre and use that as a guide. And that's especially helpful if you are working with a slightly more precious, maybe hand-dyed braid. Let's get into a bit more detail. To calculate the grist, I need to know the total length of the skein or sample in metres or yards and its weight in grams or ounces. Let me just show you how I get those figures. For a sample, I like to spin at least a gram or two. In theory, you can take a measurement even from a very small amount of yarn like a plyback sample, but handspun can be really inconsistent by nature, so I just prefer to use a larger quantity for a more accurate figure. If I'm just working with a small sample, I'll measure it in centimetres or inches with a tape measure, making sure not to stretch the yarn. For a full skein, I wind it off onto a niddy noddy or skein winder and I count the number of times that I pass the starting point. My skein winder has a counter on it, so if I'm using that, I have the luxury of not having to mentally keep track. You can also wind the skein first and count the number of wraps later, or you can get yardage counters, which are another option. When I finish winding, I record the number of wraps on my yarn label, in my written records, and in a digital system just in case the physical records are lost. I finish my yarn and leave it to dry, then measure the middle of the skein all the way around to find the average length of one loop, measuring in centimetres if I want to end up with a metric measurement, or inches if I want my grist to be imperial. Then I multiply the length of one loop by the number of niddy noddy wraps, and that's the total length of the skein in centimetres or inches. A lot of niddy noddies and skein winders are made to create a specific length of skein, like 1.5 or 2 yards, but the yarn is usually under tension at this point, and it can also grow or shrink during the finishing process, so that's why I prefer to measure the length of the skein after I've finished it. At this point, I'll convert the length of the sample or full skein from centimetres to metres by dividing by 100, or if I measured in inches, I can convert inches to yards by dividing by 36. So now I have the total skein length. What I need now is the weight in grams or ounces. For samples, I use a set of jeweller's scales with a good degree of accuracy. I'll link the exact ones that I use in the description. For a full skein, I just use my kitchen scales. And now I have all the information that I need to calculate the grist. For metric grist, I'll take the total skein length in metres and divide it by the weight in grams. That gives me the metres per gram. Then I'll multiply that by 100 to find the grist in metres per 100 grams, or I could multiply by 1,000 to get the grist in metres per kilo. For imperial grist, I use the total skein length in yards and divide it by the weight in ounces, which gives me yards per ounce. Or if I want the grist in yards per pound, then I'd multiply that by 16. As I mentioned earlier, in the hand spinning community, you'll often see grist given in yards per pound. So if you've calculated your grist in metres per 100 grams, because that's what makes sense to you, but you want to convert that to yards per pound just for comparison, multiply the number of metres per 100 grams by 4.96 and that will give you your yards per pound. Again, some people find the maths a bit overwhelming, that's totally fine, and if that described how you're feeling, stick around and I will show you my shortcut. There is an alternative method using something called a McMorran yarn balance, where you hang a piece of yarn on a little bar in an acrylic box and gradually cut pieces off until the bar is level. You then measure the remaining length of yarn in inches, multiply it by 100, and that gives you your yards per pound. I don't use that method because, first, those things are really not common in the UK. I've actually never seen one for sale here in the 14 years that I've been spinning. I think possibly because it's designed to be used for imperial measurements, and we have a very complicated relationship with imperial measurements over here. Also, as I mentioned earlier, I don't like relying on measurements based on a very small amount of handspun yarn, because if that couple of inches of yarn is a bit more dense than the rest of the skein, then the measurement could be way off. So I prefer to get a measurement that's based on an average of the whole skein. I can see a McMorran balance being useful for determining the grist of commercial yarn though, which would be a lot more consistent. If you'd like to learn more about McMorran balances, I will leave a link in the description and the pinned comment. Once I know the grist, I can use that to work out what weight of fibre I would need to spin to get the length of yarn I need for a project. Let's imagine that I've swatched with my yarn and I got a gauge and a fabric that suits my project well. Starting with metric, let's say that the project needs 1,050 metres of yarn. The grist of my yarn is 300 metres per 100 grams. I divide 1,050 by 300, which gives me 3.5. And that tells me that I need 3.5 lots of 100 grams. So 3.5 times 100 grams is 350 grams. So I'd need to buy 350 grams of fibre for my project. Realistically, I always buy slightly more than I calculate I'll need to account for samples and also some variations in my spinning. For imperial, let's say our project needs 1,150 yards and our grist is 500 yards per pound. 1,150 divided by 500 equals 2.3 pounds of fibre. An alternative use for grist is that if I know how much fibre I already have, I can work out what length of yarn I can spin from that fibre. For metric, let's say that I have 200 grams of fibre and I know that I'm getting 350 metres per 100 grams. I could multiply the grist in metres by the amount of fibre that I have available and then divide by 100, and that would tell me how many metres I could get in total. In this case, 700 metres. Or for imperial, if I had 3 pounds of fibre and I was getting 600 yards per pound, 3 times 600 is 1800 yards. Since I have a record of each handspun yarn's grist and how it was spun, if I've spun the same fibre base before, I can often just look at those records and avoid the need to sample with a more precious slash expensive fibre like a hand-dyed braid. I also use grist to help me replicate or substitute yarns. Knowing how dense the original yarn is can give me some clues about how to spin a replica that might behave in a similar way. So how do you change your spinning to make your yarn more or less dense? The lower the grist number, the denser the yarn. It just means that there are a lot of fibres really packed in there. So if the grist number is lower than you'd like, it means that you'd get less yardage from the same amount of fibre. So maybe you wouldn't quite have enough to make the sweater project that you've been planning. To make the yarn less dense, you'd need to think about how you can use fewer fibres in the same amount of space. It would take hours to go through every possible way to do this, but some examples might include using a more woolen style technique like long draw or spinning from the fold, using a carded fibre preparation, or adding less twist. All of those leave more space for air in your yarn, and more air generally means a less dense yarn. Conversely, if your grist number is higher than you would like, it would mean that you'd get more yardage from the same amount of fibre. Now that sounds like it's always a really good thing, but light, airy yarns might not drape in the way that you want them to. So if you want to make your yarn more dense, you'd need to think about packing more fibres into the same space, which you could do by spinning with a more worsted style technique, like short forward draw, using a coned preparation or adding more twist. The fibre you're using also plays a big part in the grist. For example, alpaca is generally more dense than wool, so that's another thing to take into account. Now look, I know that there has been a lot of maths in this video and I did promise you a shortcut. You see, when I was first planning this video, I thought this is pretty maths heavy and I know that there are a lot of people who get overwhelmed with the maths, myself included, so I'll leave a link to the online Grist calculator in the comments. I was absolutely sure that I'd seen one, and then I realised there wasn't an online Grist calculator, so I had to code one myself. It has options for all metric, all imperial, or a mixture of both measurements, if you like to measure in yards but weigh in grams, for example. To use it, you'll need to know either the total skein length and weight, or the number of niddy-noddy wraps, the length of a single wrap, and the weight. Choose which units your measurements are in, choose whether you already know the total skein length, type the numbers into the relevant boxes, including the yarn requirements if you have a particular project in mind, then press calculate, and out pops the grist in a few different formats. The total skein length, if you didn't already know it, the weight of the fibre you'd need to spin for your project, and it even has a rough guess at what commercial yarn weight it might be equivalent to. The yarn weight estimates are based on my own records, an average of commercial yarn weights, along with the guidance in Gillian Moreno's book Yarnitecture. But due to all of the variables involved in Handspun, please, please make sure that you swatch with your Handspun to check the gauge and make sure that you get a fabric that works for your project. And if you come across any measurements that seem way off base, please do let me know. You can access the Grist calculator from the QR code on screen, or I've left a link in the description and the pinned comment. So I really hope that you find that useful. If you do, please know that this calculator, along with all of my videos, are made possible by the financial support that I receive from my Patreon members. They've had exclusive access to the calculator up until now, and they always get to see my new videos ad-free. I also have Ko-fi, YouTube Super Thanks, and affiliate links if you'd like to contribute to the continued hosting costs of the Grist calculator, as well as all of the other work on this channel. And I kind of hesitate to say this, please let me know if there are any other spinning related calculators that you would find useful. Thank you so much for spending some time with me today. Enjoy your spinning and I look forward to seeing you again next time.